Okay, guys. Over the last year, I did two courses that were called the Mobility WOD 101 and 102. This is from Dr. Kelly Stark, who's the author of the Supple Lever. So it comes from CrossFit, right? Let's put it out there.
full disclosure. It came from CrossFit.
The cat's out of the bag. So just to give you an idea of a little bit of my background as well, I have been a huge CrossFit snob ever since its inception. So in the early 2000s, when I actually kind of learned about it when I was in Afghanistan, you know, these soldiers were talking about CrossFit and why we weren't teaching it and all that, and I just didn't know what it was. And then when I realized what it was and I saw all the research, I'm like, okay, this is just a bunch of people putting a bunch of junk together and just pushing intensity, and then injuries are happening, right? Like, that was me. And being in the military field, I've always been preaching to avoid. So through our courses, when we were teaching our other fitness instructors across the country, a few of them kind of came up to me and said, as we were trying to express exercise safety and all that, they were talking to me about this book, the Supple Lever and all that. And I'm like, whatever. And eventually I gave it a shot. And because we bought a copy at our office, and I started reading it. And I've been always kind of addicted to all these different courses to learn more about movement. And a few times I've been asking people that I kind of admire within the agency or anywhere else, I'm like, hey, what's a good course, a mobility course? They're like, oh, the mobility stuff by Kelly Starr. I'm like, oh, really? It was that good? So I decided to give it a shot. And last year, I did the 101 course, which is really neat because it's all online. It used to be a face-to-face kind of weekend thing, and now they made it all online, which is very accessible in terms of the author goes through kind of like his system, his philosophy, and he never mentions really CrossFit. It's very much separated. That's the system, and then CrossFit it's his own thing. But obviously, you can see the remnants of it, and you can see the roots that come from that. But what was interesting is the idea behind these courses is to give like the frontline people, so people that are teaching fitness group sessions or even one-on-one, but like to kind of get that bigger impact. So it's to simplify as much of the content as possible in terms of rehab or preventative strategies, so that an audience can easily understand it, and people going the course can easily identify biomarkers of what's going on and what we could do to mitigate that situation in an easy fashion. And through the 101 course, he expresses that, and he goes through what he calls archetypes. So archetypes are kind of synonymous with positions that you're gonna find yourself in, but it always depends on where the resistance is coming from. However, in these archetypes, whether you're pushing or pulling, for example, you still have to respect those biomarkers that your arms or hips are going to be in that position, which is interesting, and then he gives the examples. So those archetypes are, the first one is like, he breaks it down to upper body and lower body, extremities, if you will. So in lower body, he puts the lumbar in that area, so to stabilize the lumbar. After that, he goes into what he calls squat and hinging. He puts that in the same family because it's all about hip flexion there. Then he goes into lunging, which is more of a focus on hip extension and how the hips should behave. To my kind of like surprise, there's a pistol position, so a pistol squat, if you can imagine that. I was like, what's that doing there? That's kind of pretty high up. And the idea is not to necessarily be able to do that, but is to use that position or progressions of that position to assess how the hips, knees, and ankles kind of behave together, right? Then in the upper body, he goes to the thoracic spine, what he calls an overhead position here. So again, it could be a press, or it can be a pull, right? If you're pulling yourself, how's the shoulder behaving? How are you using external rotation to torque? Then we go down. So a lot of these, as I mentioned, stem from CrossFit vocabulary, but front rack position, which is mid-flexion of the shoulders. So this could be how it looks if you imagine a front squat, but this also could be how it looks. So we use also the push-up position to kind of assess how the behavior of the scapula is gonna look like in what they call the front rack. Press in a shoulder flexion here. So we're looking at an internal rotation and how your shoulders are gonna behave in flexion. So another biomarker here, an example of that would be, are the shoulders kind of dumping forward and creating some kind of impingement. So something that a coach can identify in a dip, someone doing a muscle up transition, things like that. So how can we assess that? And then the last one is a hang, where we have the shoulders here in internal rotation and to the sides like this, and it's the same thing. How are they behaving in these different positions? So for each of these archetypes, the second course, so the first course kind of brings you to, like, these are the archetypes. Here are some mobility drills to ensure that you're in that area. And the second course, the 102 that was a face-to-face that I got to do a few weeks ago, is all about coaches being able to assess that. So I thought that was very, very good for us as a clinic because it goes through different assessments. So when we're doing our objective kind of taking our information, he divides it in active testing. So essentially challenging the participant in how they're doing it, like the motor control of that, like is it something related to that? And then we go down a little bit the rabbit hole of, okay, if we identify anything, then we have passive tests, right? Where we put them into passive mobility and check that. And then we go more into advanced kind of challenges where we would up the intensity or the volume of whatever that might be to challenge it. So I'm not gonna go through all of this because obviously that's its own course in itself, but I will, to kind of express and show you guys this process here is I will use the pistol because this is the one that's kind of like the most complex and I find kind of interesting because it does fish out a few things. So if you're looking, if you're assessing, let's say somebody's running capabilities, right? So you're gonna look at lunge and pistols, those are gonna be the things that you're gonna play with. You could look at squat and hinging, but usually the squat won't necessarily reveal everything. But the pistol will go more into dorsiflexion of the ankles and hip extension, right? Which will tell us how the lumbar kind of behaves and all that. So for the pistol, if you guys kind of stand up here, one of the tests that he likes to do is to put the hips at a disadvantage to really see how the hips will behave in flexion and knee flexion and then ankle dorsiflexion. And it's just to squat down and try to bring your bum as close as you can to the ground while maintaining your heels on the ground as well. And just seeing how everything behaves, trying to keep the knees together and the feet together just like that. And trying to go as low as you can, right? So that was a test that I did there. And everybody here seems to be able to express good ankle dorsiflexion in that active state, which is interesting. Which I was able to do too. But something that I thought was also very interesting is when you look at the squat pattern, which this is it, oftentimes we're talking about external rotation to stabilize the knees, right? Like getting the glutes activated. But for a few of us, and I was no exception, and I'll get you to try it again, is notice how your knees behave as you go lower. So try to keep your knees together. Here you go. That's it. A lot better, good. And what happens, Natalie, with your knees in that deflection? Right? They kind of separate, right? Which which for me it was something like this. When I was going low, it was opening up there. So in my mind, I'm like, okay, external rotation, I'm stabilizing at the hips, but I'm losing alignment. I'm going into varus, and then there's all this other stuff that's happening. So I learned a little fun trick that I think would be fun to share, and I'll use you as an example if you don't mind, because you're not as bad as I was. But we'll use this here. I'll get you to grab me one of those wooden dowels, and we'll use a little box here. So you don't have to do it with a band, but the idea of the strategies behind this is to make people kind of like independent in the way that they can care for themselves, right? It's to educate, and then you have a strategy that you can do at home or at the gym when you're home here. So what I want to do, and I've done this where I kind of stuck this in my shoe and it works very fine, there's no problem. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to wrap this around her leg, almost as if she has kind of an injury and we're getting out of the woods or something here. And just to stabilize this so that she could use it here. And what I'm working on here, because her knees were kind of going out, she was flexing into a position where her feet were close together. It was kind of an expression of, so she's going into external rotation, but not active, it's passive, right? Like she's relaxing in there because she can't go into internal rotation. So here, we're missing internal rotation to stabilize the knee, which for me was kind of weird because I mean, it makes sense, but feedback, I've never gotten that. It's always missing external rotation,
yep.
Right? More so for that squat position in the feet apart. So what we're gonna do here, Natalie, is we're just gonna go into internal rotation like this, and we're gonna use methods that we all know, and PNF, and what you're gonna do is you're just gonna resist that by yourself, and you're gonna push your foot in that direction, hard, 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 as if you're rotating that way. Right? A few seconds, we breathe, and then we relax, and then you go a little bit further like this. No pain, good, and then the same thing. Hard, 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 that's it. Push against my hand. Go. So PNF, things that we're very comfortable with. And relax. Very good. And then we'll do the same thing the other side.
I like how everybody picks on Nat to use as a demonstration.
Yeah, I know.
When
I saw her, I was like, oh no, not her again.
Now you're pretty broken. Now you're pretty broken, so just come on over. I'm sure this will fix something on you.
Orange.
hitting something?
I'm just getting to my
head. And then one last time. And relax. Good. All right, now, so what I'm going to get you to do, we're just going to reassess. So feet together, knees together. And I'm not expecting anything on depth right now because it could be ankle dorsiflexion limitation, which is totally fine. We haven't done anything for that. But let's see if she's capable to keep knee alignment in a very narrow stance.
Yeah.
How's that feeling?
Better. Yeah.
Good. So the idea with this, which like this is what kind of blew my mind, is when despite this, like the difference between this and the squat, because the squat is its own category, so squat is all about hip torsion, that's the vocabulary that they use, torsion to stabilize the pelvic bone, and the knees align with the second toe, and all that fun stuff. And here when we narrow it and we see that behavior, this is, it's not because we're looking at both feet together that it's supposed to be a 2 foot stance. Here we're talking about flexion of the knee and hip on a single leg stance. So if we can get alignment and stability here, it could reflect that when we go more towards a pistol shape or what does Max call it, an airborne lunge shape, there's more chances that your external rotators are working. Yes, that's fine, but your internal rotators are also working fired up to keep that thing aligned, right? And we can move, there was other things that were fun too, and we can try to assess that. I don't know if with shoes, without shoes it's the best, but for dorsiflexion, I think we do it here. And then we can check your depth again if you want, Natalie. So this is another PNF style. I'll get you to lie on your back, and we're going to go far away here. And we're going to put our heel here like this. Just cross the band here. Something like this. Okay, that shouldn't be too painful.
I don't have
light hair, so okay, good. There we go. Alright, now I'll get you to scooch far, far, far to get that strong tension where you're kind of almost at plantar flexion.
Oh.
Yeah, you're kind of not stuck there. You want to be able to dorsiflex. And you're going to use the band to help you dorsiflex here. And what we're gonna do with our athletes here is we're just gonna cycle using that tension here to wake up the everything that helps to dorsiflex, and the band gives you that extra help here. So what I'll just get you to do as I'm talking is cycle back and forth. You know, they've prescribed about 40 of these, so you know, 5 obviously is not enough, but more volume here where your dorsiflexion you're holding, and you could do some PNF stuff here where you're holding in a few seconds, you relax, and then cycle back. So it's more kind of loosening it up that joint here. I'll get you to do both sides, and then we'll reassess if you're able to bring your hips a little bit lower.
Yep.
And then the challenge after that, we'll get Nat to see if she can hold single leg in that position,
right,
which is gonna be more motor control, right? So this is a simple example of taking an archetype that can show you faults of what the athletes can be missing, and then fishing out with a little bit other tests that you could do, and then you attack with different mobility tools, you reassess, and then now you have perhaps a change within your own session. And now you can load that person up with the athletic movements and build on that, right? So the nervous system, kind of like Max talks about, it will allow you to do it because everything is now nice and aligned. Okay.
Yeah, let's switch feet.
Yeah. I wanted to share the one, the pistol one, like I said, because it's more complex and it kind of highlights that. And also, I've been, it's one that I've been working on a lot, so I'm very familiar. Having flat feet and having that difficulty with the ankle mobility, which these things have helped me greatly. Yeah, just like that, that's perfect. So just, we're wrapping it behind the heel, and then we're crossing it above the feet. And now I can do pistols.
Sweet.
Yeah. My left side is a little bit iffy. I'm able to do 2 reps before I lose everything, but
nice.
That's pretty impressive for a few years in time. And this is what I find interesting, because when I was reading up on this pistol stuff, I was kind of rolling my eyes and thinking, you know, where are they going with this? Like, it's hyperflexion of the knee, you know, all this pressure at the ankle. Your spine is not in an optimal position. However, like, my way of thinking at it has changed. Obviously, all those risks are still there. I'm not going to throw this to people that are not ready or have no reason for doing this type of thing, but for me, this has proved very, very effective, because I have more control in single leg positions, in a flex position, and coming from a martial arts background, this helps me a lot, because I'm often standing on one leg, and even though I'm kicking, and most of the positions are going to be knee extended or hip extended with the power of the kicks, not all are, especially in the transitions, right? When we're transitioning from a kicking position and then going back your foot down or avoiding a kick, you're going to flex at the hips, knees, and ankles. And to have that more control of a pistol squat, it will help you a lot with that. But if you're only training standing, knee extended and hip extended, you won't necessarily have that buffer to save you into that position. All right, now.
Yeah.
Let's do that again, please. Feet together, knee together, and let's see where our bum goes. How does that feel? That's another thing.
But my ankles feel fine,
yeah. You seem to be going a little bit lower. And then the next, if you want to challenge yourself just for giggles, is in that position, we just extend a leg here to see how we hold. And we're looking at how the knee's gonna behave, right? It's gonna crumble in. Are we gonna lose balance? Or are we going to favor going on the ball of our foot? All kind of like errors that we want to avoid, because that's going to express faults. There you go. Right? So here, from what I can tell as a coach, we're seeing improvements in dorsiflexion, we're seeing improvements in knee stability. And we're just seeing a little bit lacking of motor control, right? So we just continue that work and challenge them. And the idea of the system is not just to stuck and do that kind of mobility stuff till the cows come home, but the idea is to pepper bounce back from a challenging activity back to mobility, challenging activity, kind of like what we do in the philosophy here, right? There you go. So that is just an example of taking an athlete through this system here, where you assess them through lumbar squat, pistol lunge, let's say for lower body, and then you have fun with whatever you think is lacking the most, and that's beneficial for their athletic development. And when you look at this kind of grid system here, you have tons of tests, and it's kind of overwhelming. And the instructors, what they say is, this is just kind of like your go-to thing. You don't do this all through all the session. You'll target a few things in one session, right? Like we're focusing on pistol, we do this, we go through the pistol tree. Maybe we go to lunge a little bit because of hip extension, and despite this being flexion dominant, we want to assess extension as well, just to make sure that there's that balance. So you kind of pick and choose your own adventure, if you will, for your client. One thing that they are strong on is they like to have the habit of these, what are they, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, these 9 archetypes, to, despite not training them all in the session because it's way overwhelming, to at least kind of assess all of them through a session quickly through a warm-up, right? So for example, if you're mostly doing lower body work, there's nothing wrong in your warm-up to get them to go into these shoulder positions just to see how they behave. You take note of it, you don't necessarily do anything for that because the focus is lower body, for example, but you see the next days and the next weeks when you're targeting your upper body, you still have a recollection of how they were the day before. And that's the idea.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah, so thanks guys.
Thanks, Daniel.
Yeah.